Happy Saturday, everybody. Welcome to the second edition of TED 407 Line Retorium. I'm your host, Dr. Danny Bristow, coming to you live and online from the beautiful campus of California State University at Community Schools. Welcome, everybody. I feel like I haven't talked to you forever. We had class 2 weeks ago, and last week we had Labor Day weekend, and today's a big day, of course. We're celebrating the anniversary of 9/11, so I hope everybody's taking a moment to reflect upon that. But this needs to be a joyous day. Today in this class, we're focusing all about cults. I mean, it is kind of a good matchup with 9/11 because it brought so many different cultures together. And I hope that this show, we start focusing on embracing diversity and looking at the strengths of everybody. It's the greatest thing about America, folks. We got the greatest country on the planet. Don't you love being an American? I'm never prouder to be an American than during the opening ceremonies of the Olympic Games. You ever watch the opening ceremonies on the Olympic Games? They have all the different countries walk into the stadium, and so you got like the Japanese team walks in, all the Japanese, and then you got like the Norwegian team walks in, they're all in blonde hair, blue eyes, and then you got America comes in, a bunch of mutts from all over the place. I mean, you get the biggest redneck in America going, "It's like we're number one. We just won the gold medal, Christiana Gucci." I mean, isn't that the greatest thing about America? Is we just accept this diversity. I mean, we live in a great city on the planet, Los Angeles. I mean, this city, you can go around the world in 80 minutes. And I really hope that we're embracing that. So today is all about culture. We're talking about how culture affects our classrooms and what role culture should be playing in our classrooms. That's kind of a non-question, though, because basically culture is being created in our classrooms. We have to learn how to work with different cultures of our students. All of our students have different cultures. And so that's going to be our question of the day, is what is your definition of culture, and how does culture affect your classroom? There you go. What is your definition of culture? How does culture affect your classroom? There are two ways to participate in this class. You don't have to be enrolled in the class to participate. First of all, feel free to just call 1-800-339-1193. Again, 1-800-339-1193. A lot of our best participants are not even enrolled in the class. Isn't that a cool service by Dominguez Hills? We're providing this to the entire world. You can watch this show online in India right now as we speak for absolutely nothing. You got to pay if you want university credits, though, and I highly encourage you to enroll at the university. If you don't want to give us a phone call, but I love hearing your phone calls, you can also participate online by sending us an email via the website, dhtv.csudh.edu, again, dhtv.csudh.edu. And I'm trying to keep it interesting today, keep it real. I always try to show some video clips and the movies that we're going to be watching clips from today. Two great movies. One of them's a documentary. I hope you caught it. Came out, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago, called Spellbound. We're not talking about the Alfred Hitchcock movie with the wonderful Gregory Peck. No, we're talking about a documentary about kids competing in the National Spelling Bee, which if you haven't seen it, go get it on Netflix. It's so inspirational. I'm going to show you a couple of clips. I hope that inspires you to go check it out for yourself in its entirety. And then the other movie we're going to be showing clips from is the movie that changed my life, the movie that made me want to be a teacher, and that is Stand and Deliver, the true story of Jaime Escalante, who recently passed away. He was a teacher at Garfield High School in East Los Angeles that taught AP Calculus and had a huge impact on scores of students, but not only that, inspired a future generation of teachers as well. Edward James Olmos was nominated for an Academy Award for his portrayal. It's just a wonderful film, and I'm going to talk all about that all semester, but we'll talk about it today for sure. Last week, or 2 weeks ago, when we started the class, we were just talking about, you know, the syllabus, that kind of boring stuff, and we started to really introduce ourselves to the whole concept of English language learners, and that's what I hope this show, what you're getting out of this show. This show is aimed specifically at teachers, but it can be applied to parents as well, even to students. The huge influx of English language learners in our schools. What can we do to work with these students? And we're always looking for great strategies, and I have a couple of ideas, but I always thought the strength of the class is to hear your ideas. And our first class, we had a ton of input from callers and from emailers, and I hope we continue that today. So again, feel free to give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. Again, 1-800-339-1193, or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu. Again, our questions of the week this week, what is your definition of culture, and how does culture affect your classroom? And why don't we throw in a fun one, too, that people can respond to. We live in the greatest city on the planet, Los Angeles, California, folks. So what is your favorite cultural activity to do here in Los Angeles? What is your favorite cultural activity to do here in Los Angeles? I was thinking about that the other night. My wife and I went with some friends to the Hollywood Bowl. And, you know, the Hollywood Bowl is just wonderful, folks. If you haven't been to the Hollywood Bowl, it's so serene and pleasant there. Last night they had the fireworks at the Hollywood Bowl. I was flying in from Savannah, Georgia, and I could see the fireworks. But it's such a great activity on the Hollywood Bowl. I'll tell you one of my favorite things about the Hollywood Bowl. It's the only place I've ever been where everybody stands up and sings the national anthem. And people really sing it. And we don't have to be in war or at the Olympic Games to be singing the national anthem. It just always brings tears to my eyes. It's such a great moment. So I've already got an email. It's like, I love this class. This is a good participation in this class. This is from Jennifer. Jennifer, thanks for emailing. Jennifer writes, in discussing Piaget's formal operational stage, the book states, only 35% of high school graduates in industrialized countries obtain formal operations. Many people do not think formally during adulthood. This surprised me. Can you give an example or elaborate on what thinking formally looks like or what it is? I don't really want to focus on that today, Jennifer. I'm really going to focus on culture. You're going into the learning stages. I don't really want to focus on... That's a question. Why don't we see that for another week? Is that all right, Jennifer? Because I really want to focus on the cultural aspects. We'll go to this another week. But I appreciate your email, and email that back when we're really focusing more on the learning stages. Just got an email from Jessica. Thank you, Jessica. Jessica writes, what is your definition of culture? Culture is those behaviors that are transmitted through a variety of different channels, such as art, theater, dance, music, media, etc. You're covering a lot of ground. Good. Your culture is also based on your background and the ways it affects who you are. My favorite cultural experience is going to see Broadway shows, plays, music, and opera. And we have plenty of those here. I remember when we saw The Lion King over at the Pantages Theater. Man, it was a really great production. I was all excited because I just saw that you might want to check this out, Jessica. Les Mis is coming out at the Amundsen, I think, next summer. And it's the 25th anniversary, so we're wanting to go check that out. Thanks for emailing, Jessica. And then I just got an email from Dominique. It writes, how do we incorporate cultural awareness to our students without being offensive or showing favoritism towards one specific culture? That's actually a great question. Because this kind of gets into that PC argument. How do we make sure everybody feels comfortable? And I think we kind of have to be a little bit looser. All of us bring our own cultures to the classroom. It's kind of like when I was a journalist, people were always asking, how can you be objective as a journalist? I don't really think you can be objective. I think you can be fair, but I don't really think you can be objective, because all of us have our own backgrounds and viewpoints and things. And I think probably the fairest way we can work with our students is always to treat them with respect and to listen to different viewpoints. This is actually something I was speaking to Savannah, Georgia yesterday, and I was talking about how I used to teach history, and I love teaching history, and I'll tell you why. The first thing I always like to tell my students is history books are usually written by the winners. Any event in history has a point of view, multiple points of view, in fact. And I like to encourage students to look at different points of view. You don't have to agree with different points of view, but it's really important to look at different points of view. I think if more people would stop yapping and start listening to each other, they'd find that they're not so far apart on a lot of their ideas. Let's take a current example, Dominique. There was that preacher in Florida who today he was going to burn the Quran in protest of Islam. So I'm always trying to figure out, what's his point of view on that? So he's equating Islam with the bombing of 9/11. If I'm not mistaken, I don't believe Islam bombed the World Trade Center. I believe it was some extremist terrorist. And, you know, I don't know if you can hold an entire religion accountable for some people on one side of it. It's kind of like when I listened to this debate about the mosque being built near the World Trade Center, I said, well, wait a second. Timothy McVeigh was responsible for the bombing in Oklahoma City, the federal building. Over 170 people died there. And Timothy McVeigh was part of a radical Catholic group. Does that mean you get rid of the Catholic churches around Oklahoma City, and do you hold Catholics accountable for that bombing? I don't believe you do. I think that any religion, any culture, any society has people that are extreme. And one of the greatest things about America, folks, is that we allow them to be heard. I mean, even the freaks have a voice. Even the people that are completely extreme, they have a voice, and it can bother people, but in a way, to me, it's celebrating our culture. I mean, we're one of the few places in the world where you can criticize your government without getting jailed. You know, we do it all the time. So I like to look at the positive elements of that. Can we also the negative things about that? I think we need to start focusing a lot more on the positives. And so even though this, and I was happy to see that this preacher decided not to burn the Quran, because I think there has to be a little bit of common sense there. The point is, you know, even if you can be angry with a person, you need to really still show them respect. And I was very happy to see that he decided to show proper respect and not do that. Thank you, Dominique, for that email. And I just said a whole bunch of things, which I guess they're going to be controversial to some people, but that's what I think. I want us to talk about it. You don't have to agree with me. Of course you don't have to agree with me. That's what the whole show is about, is different viewpoints. So we're going to talk about the demographic changes in America. And you need to understand, folks, America, we are a nation of mutts. There's been immigration patterns in this country throughout our history. Unless you're Native American, you are an immigrant. Your ancestors are immigrants. And it's something that I think we really need to embrace in this country. At any point, different groups were coming to this country in large numbers. Now, last time we were talking about, in the past 30 years, there's been some huge increases in ESL student population in this country. And I think it gives us an opportunity to embrace a whole lot of interesting new teaching strategies. There was a piece written by a wonderful German writer, Martin Niemöller. I wanted to read it to you. It's called First They Came. And I want you to listen to this. He wrote, and it's in your e-textbook, and almost all of you have purchased it. So thank you. But he wrote, in Germany, they came first for communists, and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a communist. And then they came for the trade unionists, and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a trade unionist. And then they came for the Jews, and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a Jew. And then they came for me, and by that time there was no one left to speak up. I love that. I really love that, because, again, it's showing that, you know, we're all in this together. And one of the things that I thought, I'm going to get back to this preacher in Florida that wanted to bring the Quran, I thought one of the real positives that came out was an interfaith council of Jews and Christians and Muslims, all different groups, spoke out against that. I thought, wow. So from a negative came a positive of this unification of people. I think all of us can trace our roots back to different places, and I want us to think about that when we're talking about immigrants. So, who are the ESL students in this country? You're going to hear me all semester long talking about ESL students, and most of my examples are usually with Spanish-speaking students. People always say, hey, well, it's not right. There's students that aren't Spanish-speaking in schools, and you know what, there are. I mean, here in Los Angeles, I think there's been identified over 400 different languages being spoken in the school classrooms. I mean, matter of fact, I had a teacher a couple of years ago. She was teaching first grade in Hollywood. She had 20 first graders, 19 different languages in that classroom. I mean, that's pretty significant. That being said, you need to know 80% of ESL students in this country, 80%, 80, 80% of them, Spanish is the language being spoken at home. That's why I so often use that. Here in Los Angeles, it's all around that same percentage. It's by far the largest percentage. I just read an interesting statistic based on government data on the census, and they said this year, the entering kindergarten class in the country, in the United States, one out of four kindergartners in this country is Hispanic. Now, just because they're Hispanic doesn't mean they're Spanish-speaking. I mean, that's another misconception also we have to pay attention to. Just because your last name is Rodriguez doesn't mean you speak Spanish. I'll show in a couple of weeks, one of my favorite movies of all time is Born in East L.A., and it's about Cheech Marin. He grew up in East L.A., and he doesn't know anything about Spanish or Mexico or anything, but people just assume because he's Mexican-American, he knows all that stuff. So these are types of cultural assumptions we have to pay attention to. Hispanic population is a large, growing segment in this country, and so that's why we'll be talking about that. Well, when it gets to second place, we're talking Asian and Pacific Islanders, and that makes up lots of different cultures, from Chinese immigrants, Vietnamese immigrants. You should see a lot more about Thai immigrants. It's interesting. Laotian, Korean, here in Los Angeles. So I think it's very interesting. And again, the other thing to pay attention to is the population of white non-Hispanic students in this country is starting to decrease. We saw in the last census, California, for the first time in 100 years, now has no majority of any one group. The total population dipped below 50% for white students in this country. Got a couple more emails while I was talking. Let's see what we got. I have Lisa. Lisa, thank you for emailing. Lisa writes, I think the culture is based on one's beliefs, convictions, upbringing, and traditions. Thank you, Lisa. Really appreciate that. You know, and what I really appreciate, folks, is how active you are on the emails. Even if I don't get to read your email on air, I get a big printout at the end of class of everybody that was participating online, and I get to review your questions and your comments. So thank you for that. Jaime writes, thank you, Jaime. Cultures, behaviors, and beliefs, characteristics of a particular social, ethnic, or age group. It affects your classroom because teaching in LA, your class is going to be filled with various people from various backgrounds. That's exactly right, Jaime. It's important to validate a student's background to build their confidence and connect with students. I'm very happy you're saying that, Jaime. You're the person I want in the classroom. His favorite cultural event in Los Angeles is the various powwows that happen at various locations. They're very peaceful and relaxing. I've never been to a powwow, Jaime. You have to tell me more about a powwow. I don't know what you're talking about. You sit in the teepee and share the pipe, or what's a powwow? Am I that lame? Maybe I'm just an old guy. I don't even know what a powwow is. What a lame guy. Thank you for writing in, Jaime. Kenzie writes, thank you, Kenzie. Each student will walk into the classroom as a part of any number of cultures. Absolutely right. And all of us, just in lots of different cultures. They may be from a different ethnic culture than you or the other students, a different religious culture, etc. Absolutely. I think it's important to remember that your classroom is also a culture. Absolutely right. And this is one of the points I'm trying to get to. I appreciate that you're saying that, Kenzie. And you can create your own culture within your own classroom. Absolutely right, Kenzie. I mean, I'm glad you're saying that. I'm trying to create a culture in this classroom. The culture I'm trying to create, if you saw in the first class, is one of the things a lot of students comment to me is my grading policy. Because if you watched the first episode, my grading policy has always been this. As long as you do all your work, you have an A. And people are like, dang, that's ridiculous. That's not a very high standard. Actually, it's a high standard. It's a higher standard than if I were just randomly assigning grades. I'll tell you why. I'm putting the onus on you. I want this to be your class. You're grown-ups. Do you want to learn or not? I mean, if you want to get an A and do nothing, you know, I'll accept 50% of the blame. If you want to get your A and put a ton of work into it, I'll accept 50% of the credit. You know, I'm empowering you to be self-motivated because I really feel that motivation has to come from within. I mean, I can use the fear tactic, which I think grades often do, but I don't think forcing you to learn makes you want to become a lifelong learner. I mean, I want you to actually be interested in these things on your own right. And I think that's one of the things I love about working with teachers that are constantly looking for strategies to improve their teaching methods. Kenzie continues to write, each student is part of that culture, and the classroom culture ought to allow each student to bring their other cultures into the classroom and have it mixed in and shown homage like all the others. Good. Thank you so much for emailing that, Kenzie. That was a great email. I appreciate it. And Sue writes, my favorite cultural activity is my beloved book club. Sue, I have a book club. You should go online to my book club. It's called LazyReaders.com. LazyReaders.com. If you subscribe, it's a free subscription once a month for the rest of your life. I update it with 10 new book recommendations, 3 or 4 adult level, 3 or 4 young adult level, and 3 or 4 children's level books, all under 250 pages, so you can have something to read during your faculty meetings. We also have a link to Amazon.com. If you follow the link, anything you purchase on Amazon, they donate 10% of the purchase to Bookends, which is a local charity here in Los Angeles, created by an 8-year-old kid that creates classroom libraries and under-resourced areas. They've already donated over 2 million books to classroom teachers throughout the country. Let's hear more from Sue. She says, about her book club, we're a group of moms who met at a Parent Ed Mommy and Me class 12 years ago. That's great. There are 11 ladies, half foreign born. Oh, that's interesting. We have so much in common with kids the same age and a love of books, but we bring such different backgrounds to our discussions. And isn't that great? So I love being around. I was saying this yesterday with some teachers in Spanish. Or I said, you know, if I was ever president, I'd surround myself with people that disagree with me. It's so much more interesting to talk to people that view the world in a very different way. I'm always trying to get into people's heads and trying to figure out how they're thinking. So I love that you're in that group. And sometime I want you to email me some of those books that you're all reading. My friend and mentor at USC, Stephen Crash, and he started a book club with all these, there's all these engineering students from Asia, and their wives didn't really speak English very well, so he started a babysitters club, a book club, with these women, and they increased their English reading fluency by like almost 12 years within a 1-year period, just by all of them became addicted to these books and started reading them like crazy, and then they got into like Sweet Valley High and stuff like that. Thank you for that email, Sue. And we'll do one more before I get to a video clip I want to share. We got Lisa. Lisa, thank you for emailing. Lisa writes, culture is all behaviors, practices that shape an individual or group. Culture affects your classroom and that each student comes to your class with a variety of behaviors and practices and beliefs that have shaped them up to that point. So you need to be aware of what they are and how to work with all the individuality to bring it together and have each student's culture be recognized. That is a very long sentence, Lisa. It was a Hemingway sentence. It's a very extensive definition, though. Thank you for being so comprehensive with your definition. All right, I do want to get to this first video clip from the movie Spellbound. It's a little bit longer than I like to do the video clips usually. I try to keep the clips to 5 minutes or less. This is about a 10-minute clip. But I kind of want to really sell you on this documentary because I really want you to check it out on Netflix. The movie's called Spellbound, and it's about kids participating in the National Spelling Bee. Now, this first clip is about this girl, Angela. And you know what? I wanted to show you the immigrant experience, and I'm just going to let the video speak for itself. So enjoy this 10-minute clip. It's from the film Spellbound. This is Angela from Texas.
How do you classify my diet?
Boring. Number one, boring. There's nothing much to do except go to the theater.
Terrible. I know.
It's terrible.
I've had some of my friends sign the cards, like Chelsea. She's a good friend of mine. If I see that name and it's right next to the word, I kind of think that she's cheering me on, you know, to win the spelling bee. I also wrote down words on poster board, and I glued them on here, and I kind of made this little crossword puzzle.
Who taught you these methods of learning spelling?
I guess I kind of just came up with them myself.
Woo!
Woo!
Angelo kind of giving him a hard time the other day that he didn't know any English. He said, you know, you've been here 20 years and you can't speak English. He said, well, I've been taking care of cattle for 20 years. They don't speak English.
He's worked here practically, I think, for about, what is it, 19 or 20 years now?
20.
Huh?
20.
30.
20.
20. I knew it was 19 or 20 he's worked here. He's a real reliable. He's a reliable Mexican. And of course, you run off to Mexicans pretty reliable. They're not all just bones and trannies, you know. There's a lot of good ones that may step in them.
Border Patrol agents. Senator Judith Zaffarini wants to give agents the right to make arrests, searches, and seizures for violations of state law. The father of a border agent shot to death last year is the one who requested the legislation.
They're just so proud. I mean, they didn't come over here for nothing. They thought we would have better educational opportunities over here. And I guess it has all been worth it for them.
Le pagué a un coyote $500 y me vine a las 6 de la mañana de mi casa y para las 6 de la tarde ya estaba en Albuquerque.
He was scared because back in his youth he had tried crossing illegally and he had gotten caught and spent quite a bit of time in an immigration detention center, and he wasn't treated very well. I kind of had an idea, as old as I was, believe it or not, that, you know, we weren't doing what was right. To me, I just, you know, I remember my mother as, you know, such an innocent girl back then that was, you know, had these two children, and I remember, you know, actually walking to the river. She held me by the hand and had my sister in her arms when we crossed.
Who are you talking about, Angela?
How did she learn to speak English so well since they speak Spanish all the time?
Well, the first way, first deal, she's smart. She don't have to hear something at one time, and she knows what it is.
When I took her home the other afternoon, she said, "Miss Lauren, what if I don't win?" And I said, "So you don't win. You know, you won, so you don't spell the right word, okay?" I said, "Then you don't have to study for the next month." She said, "Yeah." You know how she is. Yeah.
I have been waiting for tomorrow, for that day. I've been waiting for it forever, all year. And I can finally say tomorrow is the regional spelling bee. I can finally say that.
As you know, the spellers are under a tremendous amount of stress and pressure. So we got here, if you need to talk, we always keep as quiet as you possibly can.
Speller 21. Cultivation.
Cultivation. C-U-L-T-I-V-A-T-I-O-N. Cultivation.
P-E-D-A-N-T-I-C. We're spelling R-A-P-P-E-L-L-E-D. Could I have spellers 21, 24, 25, 26, 27?
A-N-G-S-T-R-O-S-S.
That's a
fee.
A-N-G-S-T-R-O-S-S. blood type, radius, chateau, renaissance, repression, ectomella, interrogatory, prophylaxis, feasible, quick primary scan, local layout, justice, legal, valetudinarian.
V-A-L-E-T-U-D-I-N-A-R-I-A-N.
Cabania. C-A-B-A-N-Y-A.
Why is it correct? Angela, you now have a chance to solve championship for me.
Crocodile.
C R O C O D I L I A N.
We have a chance.
An eighth grader in Harrington was the guest of honor at the pep rally and parade today. Angela Renovar is off to Washington, D.C. this weekend for the National Spelling Bee. She's the regional spelling champ, and today, Angela's teachers and classmates gave her a royal send-off.
Renovar, R-E-N-I-V-A-R, in case you're wondering. See you tonight.
Good night.
Man, I was crying after the spelling bee. I've never cried, like, for being happy, you know? And that's how happy I was.
Your dad was crying.
Oh, I've never seen my dad cry.
He's going to go. He didn't really want to go at first, but, you know, he's been out here for 20, 25 years. He came here. I think that it would be closing for him to go to Washington and see Angela because this is what he came here for. He didn't come out here to work. I mean, that's part of it. But the closing in it for me, the end of the story, is for him to get to go to Washington and see her.
That is the movie Spellbound. That's just a touching video. I absolutely love watching that movie. Angela, I mean, look at that little girl. She comes up with all these strategies on her own on how to learn the different spelling words. I mean, this is what a good teacher's doing all the time. Dude, you see how excited her teacher was for her too? I absolutely probably my favorite part of that whole video are the ranch owners, the old guy, and he's like, well, you know, he's one of the Mexicans that ain't lazy, you know. You know, I just love the different generations. God bless them. I think that's just fantastic. All right, so today we're talking all about culture, and that's the movie Spellbound. I'm going to show you one more clip from that here in a little bit. I hope you enjoyed that clip. The whole point is to show that little girl was living the American dream, and that's what her brother, the older son, was talking about, was the guy who came to this country, and he created a better life for his family. And to me, it's a beautiful story. We're talking about culture. I've been getting all kinds of great emails from everybody. Haven't gotten a phone call yet, though. I always love to hear your voices and hear your input. So just call 1-800-339-1193 or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu. The question of the day is, what is your definition of culture? How does culture affect your classroom? And then our fun question is, what's your favorite cultural activity to do here in Los Angeles? I said the Hollywood Bowl was one of my favorite activities. He was Jaime. He said, oh, wow, it was nice. I still don't know what he's talking about. He's going to have to email me that one. There's so many great things, to do in this town. I used to golf at that par 3 golf course over at Los Feliz. That's a great cultural activity. There's that one Sunday over at Olvera Street where the Cardinal blesses all the animals. I think that's a pretty cool little cultural activity. I like going Friday mornings. My wife is from Singapore. We love Chinese food. So we'll go on Friday mornings over to Chinatown at Empress Pavilion for dim sum. That's a great cultural activity. So tell me all your favorite cultural activities here in Los Angeles. So many different things to do here. Great, great city. So we're talking about culture and defining culture. All of you have been giving some really great definitions. And one of the things I love that you're hitting upon, definitions of culture can refer to activities like art, movies, sports. These are all types of culture. They can refer to groups like you say African Americans or teenagers or Iowans. Can be used to generalize even further, like we are all Americans, we are all Earthlings, things like that. As teachers, we really want to learn about the cultures of our students. We want to get beyond the superficial things. You know, being Hispanic doesn't just mean celebrating Cinco de Mayo every year, and being African American doesn't mean we have the shortest month of the year. February is African American History Month, Black History Month. You know. But I got to tell you, it always drove me nuts. Black History Month drives me nuts because if I'm doing my job, it's Black History Year. We're talking about Black history and Asian history and Hispanic history and all history. That's my job. We need to know that culture is shared. It affects our behaviors and it affects our beliefs. And I believe it was Hensley that said this too. Teachers create a classroom culture. You know, seeing the teachers that have stuck by the book culture. And, you know, more laid-back culture. You know, this is something I want to point out, folks, because I have a lot of teachers that come up to me when I'm working with them. They're like, oh, Danny, I can't be like you, I'm not as energetic because you want to, wait a second. Don't get me wrong on that, folks. I have a policy. If you're not funny, don't make jokes. And what I mean by that is you need to teach the way you're comfortable feeling teaching. You know, because I've watched lots of different teachers, and style is very overrated. I mean, some teachers love this and stuff, but I've also seen very, very quiet elderly women who are very gentle with everybody. I mean, my son's kindergarten teacher is an elderly woman who's the most gentle, nicest human being I've ever met, and she's a fantastic teacher. You know, I've seen whole strict teachers that are like, you know, they're like, you're going to do this right now. I mean, they're very strict, tough love, and they're fantastic teachers. So don't let style get in your way. However you feel comfortable, that's the way you should be teaching. So let's get into some perceptions of culture. Talk about cultural universalism. All human beings create culture. And another thing that's kind of interesting to me is each group tends to view its culture as the best. I think we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, how, you know, if you ever look at a world map in America, what's in the middle of the map? America. If you look at a world map in Spain, what's in the middle of the map? Spain. If you look at it in Australia, the map is turned upside down and Australia is in the middle of the map. I always think that's fantastic. Now, macro culture simplifies. It simplifies our living. So there's macro cultural items in society all the time. So these are things that make things life easier. So here in America, you always drive on the right-hand side of the road. And so if you notice, kind of when you're walking on a sidewalk, people tend to walk on the right-hand side of the sidewalk, and it kind of messes things up when people walk on the left-hand side. These are little things. When I'm teaching classes on campus, it's fascinating to me. You have a class of maybe 50 students, and the first night of class, everybody sits in their seats. And the second week of class, everybody's trying to sit in that same seat. You know, there's people don't really ever move around. You start to get comfortable on things like that. People talk about, oh, we need change. When it comes to actual changes, you know, back me up. It kind of cracks me up, this whole healthcare debate right now, is the president, his entire campaign was, I'm going to change the healthcare system. You know, and so he had the audacity as president to change the healthcare system, and people are like, what? It's so human. It's human nature. We talk one way, and then when it actually happens, we're like, whoa, we gotta slow this down. I was kind of like that with my wife. You know, when we were dating, I'm like, oh, I don't want to get married ever and stuff. And then she's like, well, I'm gonna start dating other people, and all of a sudden, like, will you marry me? Is that ridiculous? Americans and human beings in general, just the most fascinating creatures. I wish I was an alien coming to study our habits. It's absolutely fantastic. Cultural relativism Let me look at my notes for some things I want to point out. Students may come from diverse cultures that may be quite unlike a macro culture. It's something to pay attention to, especially here in Los Angeles. We have a lot of different cultures here, folks. I think one of the greatest things about Los Angeles is we have so many cultures we're just used to. Literally, folks, you can walk around in your pajamas in this town and nobody even blinks. There's film production all the time. Nobody's like doing this in front of the camera. They're just kind of used to it. You do that in other parts of the country. It's quite different. Cultural relativism means that actions may only be judged in relation to the cultural setting in which they occur. Translation, get to know about your students' cultures. It always kind of drives me nuts when I hear the term Hispanic. I have a lot of Hispanic students. There's a lot of brown folks. You know, a student from Mexico is very different from a student from Guatemala, very different from a student from Cuba. These are all Hispanic students, but they're different. Even within Mexico, there's different regions. It's kind of like saying you're American. Folks, being American is so many different things. This is why I think it's such a waste of time for the government to try and nationalize standards. Why? Why do we want everybody to be the same? We don't need to be the same. We should all be different. California, totally different than Georgia. I was in Georgia yesterday. Georgia's a lovely state. You know, I hope it keeps its culture and is part of the American culture, but I want it to be Georgia. I don't need to see the P.F. Chang's and McDonald's in Georgia. I want to see some Southern fried burger. You know, California, I want to see the great Mexican food, Asian cuisine and stuff. You know, I don't understand why we want everybody to be the same. It doesn't have to be that way. I've always loved the flavors. Give me the local flavor. And it's kind of the whole weird thing in education. We're saying, oh, we all have to have the same students. Like, why? For what purpose? Doesn't it make us stronger to have diverse opinions and backgrounds? I've always thought that's what makes us the strongest country on the planet. It's because we do have those diverse cultures and opinions and stuff. When we all start to merge into one, that's when you start to have the problems, I think. It becomes like that, what's that Dr. Seuss book with the sneeches and everything? Everybody, oh, we have the stars and you're not as good as us. You know, read Dr. Seuss, most kids' books can actually deal with culture better than adult books. I think it's very underrated. Okay, I'm talking enough. Maybe I should get to a couple of your emails. Elizabeth just emailed. Thank you, Elizabeth. Elizabeth writes, a powwow is a gathering of Native Americans. They include singing, dancing, and socializing. There's one day in L.A., 9 to 5. They will be having free food. Okay. I didn't know that they had powwows in Los Angeles. I didn't know it was actually like a Native American. I mean, I'm from originally Durango, Colorado, Southwest Colorado, so we had the Utes, but we're near the Navajo Reservation, too. They had powwows. I thought this was some kind of term. So thank you for pointing that out to me, Elizabeth. I had no idea they had that in Los Angeles. And Elizabeth writes, my favorite thing to do is karaoke singing, swing dancing, and dragon boat racing. That's great. That's awesome. I swing dancing. I went to that after the movie Swingers. I took the classes up over at the Derby. So that's great. Paul just wrote, thank you, Paul. I teach at a 97% Latino school. Oh, that's a smaller population than any schools in Los Angeles. And the struggle has been to expose these students to the real diversity outside of their community. That's a good point. That's a really good point. Field trips are not enough. Any thoughts on how to open their minds to diverse cultures? Now, Paul, I love this email. You know what? We learn a lot from Japanese. In Japan, by law, 31 school days a year are mandatory field trip days. Now, as a teacher comp, and we're lucky to get one every 3 years. Now, you can either take the stance of the right-wing teacher say and gripe about it, or you can be the effective teacher and actually do something about it. If you can't take your kids out into the world, Paul, your job is to bring the world into your classroom. I mean, we live in a great community, folks, Los Angeles, California. We got it all out here. You know, we have over 200 universities and colleges, community colleges in the area. One of the things I used to do when I was teaching in Compton, my students were predominantly Latino and African American. And so I was constantly bringing in international students from USC and UCLA, Loyola Marymount, and Cal State Dominguez Hills. And, you know, I get students from Iran and India and Taiwan. It doesn't take a lot to turn on a third grader. They come up and go, can you speak Chinese? And the person speaks to me and they're like, oh, that's awesome. Expose your kids to those different types of things. I love that you're thinking about that, Paul. That is our job. Our job is exposure. I always thought that's the job of a parent. My parents were such good parents because they took us places. Now, I was told, parents, you know, open up the Thursday edition of the Los Angeles Times. It shows you all the great free activities every weekend in Los Angeles. You know, it doesn't take a lot of money to expose your kids to tons of wonderful cultural experiences. And Elizabeth just wrote that there's a powwow. Today, I'm sure it's free to go to the powwow. One of my favorite things in the world to do in Los Angeles is to go up to Will Rogers State Park off of Sunset Boulevard and just hike. It has one of the most beautiful views of the ocean and downtown. You know, take a walk along the Strand on the beach from Santa Monica to Torrance. It's just beautiful. There's so many great things to do. Walk around, Long Beach, man. The Pike is a wonderful area just to walk around. You take a little boat taxi around the harbor. There's so many great things to do in the city. But that's our job as teachers as well, is to provide all of those experiences. Well, our job is to give these experiences. I hope I've given you a couple ideas. If I haven't, write me again, and I'll give you some more. We got our first call of the day. I'm so excited. Let's see who we have on the line. We have Terrell Powell from Los Angeles. How are you doing, Terrell?
I'm good, Doc. How are you?
Fantastic. Thanks for your call. What can I do for you?
All right. I have a question for you.
Right.
Okay. What steps do you take to change the culture in the classroom? Let's say if it's one where the students, you know, they don't have, you know, good work ethic or whatnot.
Yeah.
And do you put a timetable on that?
That's the question, timetable. I don't know if I have a very good answer for the timetable, Terrell, but I do have an answer for the first part. It was Somerset Maugham who once said, if you refuse to accept anything but the best in life, you very often get it. And there's a great book I once read that said you should try and treat other people the way you want to be treated. And I always requested to get kids that nobody else wanted. I mean, if you're going to be a teacher, why not go for the biggest challenge, is what I say. And I always call my students underachieving geniuses, and I always say, you know, you are going to do amazing things. It was Michelangelo who once said, the biggest mistake in society is not that we, how's it go? The biggest mistake is not that we set our soul. It's something I'm just trying to say, Terrell. It's like the biggest mistake is not that we set our goals high and we miss them, but we set them low and we reach them. You know, and I always told my students, you are capable of anything. I mean, we live in the greatest country. I mean, this isn't possible in a lot of places on the planet. Here in the United States, anything is possible. You have a woman who grew up poor, who was raped as a girl, who all kinds of disadvantages, and she winds up making herself into a billionaire talk show host named Oprah Winfrey. There's not another place on the planet that could have happened. So, for me, it's a matter of getting my kids to see how a successful person thinks, Terrell. Because I deal with this a lot. I think you and I are coming from the same background of working with a lot of students that might be really disengaged and what school's not nothing for me. And it's a matter of figuring out what's the motivation for each individual. Everybody has their own type of motivation. Everybody has their own interests. I've never found a kid who isn't an expert at something. Maybe their expertise. I'll give you an example, Terrell. I had a second grader, Kiara. And Kiara, his first grade teacher told me, Kiara, I don't know nothing. I'm like, really? Great. Thank you. I love the expectation of that teacher. All right. Kiara, who didn't know nothing, he'd come in my classroom every day and be like, hey, you see that? He had 18 bulls, 16 points. No. Kiara knows a lot. He knows everything there is to know about NBA basketball. And Kiara's teacher told me he couldn't read well. Every single day, I sat there with Kiara, and we read nothing but the LA Times sports page, going through stats and stories. And by the end of the year, he was one of my best readers, you know. And I told Kiara, I'm like, you know what? What do you want to be when you grow up? You know, and every fifth grade boy I've ever talked to wants to be an NBA basketball player. And I was telling him, that's great. That's a wonderful goal. There's 150 job openings a year. 150. All right. Did you know that there's 25,000 positions a year open for doctors, and over a lifetime, a doctor makes a lot more money than an NBA basketball player? I said, go for that frame. I want you to become an NBA basketball player, but I also want you to know that Michael Jordan, he also finished his degree at North Carolina. You know, give them options. So I always set those expectations extremely high. The timetable part, Terrell, I'll tell you why I don't have a timetable, Terrell, because I used to, when I started, I'm like, we're going to get this done by now. And then when I missed that deadline, I always considered myself a failure. And I don't do that anymore because I've learned that kids blossom at different times. You know, It's, to me, it's one of the strengths of the American education system that's not being pointed out enough right now. I saw my little ones, I'm like, I hope to God this isn't the best year of your life. I hope it's next year, and the year after that, I hope you're getting better every single year. I mean, I play high school football with some guys that are still talking about when we played high school football together. And I'm like, that is the most pressing thing on the planet. I want my kids constantly striving to improve themselves. And so I've got a lot of kids that in September, they were surfing glue, and I had serious thoughts about that kid, but by April, they were moving mountains. And so I let kids go on their timetable. There's that saying, when the student is ready, the teacher appears. And I never give up on a kid, I'll never give up on a kid. So a lot of those kids that seem like they're impossible, that's the biggest success story you're ever going to have. And I hope you have those. Did that answer that question for you, Terrell?
Yeah, that works. I appreciate it.
All right. You call back anytime. I really appreciate the call. I love hearing your voice, Terrell. Thank you. We open up the floodgates. I hope to get a whole bunch more calls right now. That's 1-800-339-1193. We're talking all about culture. And what I liked about Terrell's question is he was really focused on the classroom culture. And that's a big thing for me. It's a big thing for me, a classroom culture where we're going to succeed. One of my favorite movies of all time is Hoosiers. And Hoosiers with Gene Hackman's got the small-town basketball team. And there's a scene in the movie where the worst player on the team has to make two free throws to win the game. And so Gene Hackman, he gathers the guys in the huddle and he says, okay, after Ollie makes both free throws, I want you guys to get back in your regular defense. And it's the last thought he put into Ollie's head. You're going to make both those free throws. But how often do you see people putting negative thoughts in kids' heads? I mean, so many parents, I see them drop off their kids at school and they're like, I'm sure you don't get run over today. My kids like this. What about that in the kid's head? You know, every day. I actually used to keep track of it. I used to actually have every kid's name on a clipboard, and every time I gave them a compliment, I put a check next to their name. My goal was every day, I always had about 33 students, so every kid got at least one check. Every day I had seven kids I focused on to give at least five compliments. I'm like, hey, Terrell, you're a really good writer. Someday, I want to be reading about you in Sports Illustrated, some of your writing. You know, put that thought in the kid's head. You know, you can do it. You have no idea what kind of impact that might have. I had a lot of teachers that told me specific things. You know, but I grew up in that kind of environment, and that's the kind of environment I want to give other people. My wife, she grew up in Singapore in a very negative environment where people were telling her what she couldn't do. You know, I'm so blessed, man. One of my favorite photos, a picture of me when I was 4 years old, and I'm wearing space boots, a San Diego Charger football jersey, a sheriff's badge, and a fireman's helmet, because I was going to be the first ever astronaut, professional football player, police officer, firefighter. You know, that's the environment I grew up in. My parents, they always say, don't care what you do, just be the best at it. Try your hardest. My parents never asked me if I was going to college. They asked, how high a degree are you going to get? It's the expectations, folks. I have high expectations for kids. You know, I was telling my kid, you know, that's why I use poetry. I've got a wonderful poem from Emily Dickinson. I can't remember the whole one. Let me try to remember something. It goes, I'm nobody, who are you? Are you nobody too? And there's a pair of us, you know. Don't worry, don't tell. How dreary to be somebody, how public like a frog, to live your life, to live long day, to an admiring bog. Yeah, I always show that poem to kids because I'm like, you know what? This woman has some serious self-esteem issues. And Emily Dickinson, she never sold a poem while she was alive. They found all her poems in the attic. This woman died without ever realizing the joy she would bring to so many future generations of people. And it's one of the things that obsessed kids from day one, folks. You were put here to share your poetry with the world. Maybe your poetry is actual poetry. Maybe your poetry is throwing a basketball through a hoop. Maybe your poetry is bringing a smile to your teacher's face every single day. I mean, this is why I became a teacher. And, you know, we're going to talk about this all semester long. What's good for ESL students is good for all students. You're blessed to have ESL students. I'm a better teacher. Thank you for that, Christopher. I really appreciate it. Let's get back to some of the emails we got. Carl writes, there are cultural differences make our schools diverse and unique. I think it's great that the students can learn about so many different cultures. I agree, Carl. My favorite cultural activity, FPAC. Philippine Arts and Culture, which is actually taking place tomorrow in San Diego. Oh, I'll have to check that out. That's pretty cool. My roommate in college was Filipino from Zamboanga, which is actually taking place. Okay, so it's in San Diego. There's dancing, arts, fast food, and good people getting together to celebrate Philippine culture. I love it. Thank you so much for that email, Coral. I really appreciate that. Let's talk a little bit more about, well, you know what, why don't we get to this other video clip. I got another video clip from Spellbound. This is a shorter one. I try to always keep them under 5 minutes. That first one just always moved me. I want to show you. So this one is a little girl whose family immigrated to the United States from India. It's fascinating that you get all these immigrant kids that are competing in the national English spelling bee. But it's fascinating also. This little girl, Nupur, she's really got her act together. And I hope you enjoy this this brief 4.5 minute clip from the movie Spellbound.
This is a sign for
my parents were very pressured to succeed, especially in India, because academics there are taken very, very seriously.
People from India have a very strict philosophy about education with their children, and I notice that with all the children from India who come into my class, I'm always thrilled to see any child come in who is from India, because I know that they're going to have a great work ethic and they're going to be good students, and I've never been wrong, not one single time.
I'm not wrong.
L-A-I-C-I-Z-E. B-U-S-H-I-D-O.
She always liked big words for some reason. Yeah, but because of what the British liked it.
She would say things like, I don't have any opportunities, and she had no idea what opportunity meant, so she liked the sounds. So that's what you remember, 2.5, and she had no opportunity.
Munchausen syndrome. M-U-N-C-H-A-U-S-E-N.
She had a lot of trouble beating the trio there, Sid, Alex, and Xu Jing.
It was the 8th grade B, and they were going to send the 8th grade representative to Tampa Tribune to compete.
All we did was try to win.
I wanted to beat them. They would be like, oh, Nupur, we're going to go out there and we're going to beat you. We're going to try so, so, so hard.
She had this little tactic. She was fabulous. She was not nervous.
And then I remember one of the boys, especially the one who seemed very confident, he had the word mongrel, and suddenly he blanked out.
I spelled it M-O-N-G-R-O-L. I don't know. I guess I was just pretty nervous.
And then it was the three of us, two of those boys, and me. We went on for, I think, 11 or 12 rounds.
Well, I got out and snapped the show.
He was a fast speller. He didn't like definitions. So he started going, S-T-H-T. And then all of a sudden, he goes and he covers his face with his hands, and he's like, no.
My word was, iridescent. I liked it. I thought it had 2 R's. A lot of people thought it had 2 R's.
And then we started looking it up in the dictionary, so we waited up there for 5 minutes, and I remember him wringing his hands the whole time, wondering, oh my gosh, am I right? Am I right? He wanted to win. He wanted to win very badly. He was wrong.
That's our story.
Yeah. And that was the most nerve-wracking experience of this entire, of all these preliminary bees.
She was very happy, and her mother was very happy. I was boo-booing, sobbing, you know, so hard that they came over to me and said, you must be her mother.
They are part of this community. People accept them for who they are and can look beyond differences, you know, to find things that are common.
We're very community involved. We saw one of the people from our community being recognized as a spelling bee champion, and so we right away put it up and congratulated her.
Last year, I would say the only bad experience I had the entire beat was getting out. This year, I came back with a lot more determination.
And I said, you know, you could always come back next year. And she said, oh, I am. I'm coming back next year. She said, I know what to do. I'm going to work.
You won't get any second chances in India the way you do in America.
It's just that you don't get any second chances in India. I mean, it's one of the things I embrace about the American education system. Plus, it's another emphasis on why I love immigrants. I mean, they appreciate a lot of the stuff that people born in this country don't appreciate. Don't you love her teacher, too? The one thing about her teacher, though, that I think she's great. She did a great job. She's really supportive of the student. But one thing I want you to kind of be careful of that she said is, she's like, oh, I love getting the Indian students because I know they're going to have great work ethic. And that's, all right, it's past the stereotype that she's getting, but it is a stereotype, folks. And heaven forbid she get an Indian kid that's a little bit lazier, but she has that type of attitude towards. I think it's a little bit iffy. This is one of the reasons I don't want to be accumulative files on students. I don't want to know anything about the kids. I don't want to know anything about them. I don't want to know anything at all. I want them to come in today, and I have zero preconceptions about that kid. The only preconception I should have is you are going to excel in this classroom based on where you're starting. We're going to go a long ways this year. So that's something I really want us to be cognizant of. I really love the movie Spellbound. I'm not going to tell you how it ends, but I'm going to tell you it's an amazing ending of who wins this movie. The movie profiles eight kids, and one of the eight kids they profile actually winds up winning the National Spelling Bee, and this is out of like 280 people that compete. I've got more to talk about. I'm getting to know your ESL students, but I like to always give us a break midway through the show. So we're going to take about a 10-minute break. I want you to go to the restroom, grab a coffee and a bagel or whatever, and I will see you back here in 10 minutes for more on our Talk About Culture. See you in 10 minutes, everybody.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Tiffany from Cal State Dominguez Hills Athletics, and welcome to the Toros Coaches Corner. Please welcome the head coach for the men's basketball program, Damon Powell. Hi, Coach.
How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing?
Good. Nice to be here.
Yeah, welcome. We enjoyed a great season, despite having just four returning players. Tell us what the team learned from that experience, and what we can look forward to this year.
I think the thing that our team learned from that experience was how to stick together. I'm most proud of the team. It's even when we're going through a hard time, they kind of stuck together.
Is this the year we regain our position as one of the elite teams in the conference?
I think so. Yeah, I think the last 3 years, people regard us as one of the elite teams, and we're going to be up there again.
And what can people expect to see when they come out to watch the Toros this season?
Every year, I hope the fans are saying the team played hard, the team played passionate. And we'll lose, you know, you can't win every game, but we'll lose. I hope that people think that about us, and we played hard, we defended, we played the right way, we were respectful, and we represented the university well. So that's what it's always my goals every year.
Well, Coach, we thank you for joining us on this edition of the Toros Coaches Corner. And until we see you in the stands, remember to make every day your masterpiece. So, go Toros.
Go Toros.
Hi, my name is Bart, and I'm a ceramics major. I transferred from Long Beach City College to Cal State Dominguez because of the helpful faculty, staff, and their amazing programs.
I basically took the distance learning course because I'm trying to get my California credential. I'm an out-of-state teacher. It's very convenient. I took last semester the health course in John Chase, and I found that to be my liking. I could study, relax, do it casually, and confines of my home.
I took one of the distance learning classes basically for convenience. It was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home, or if it didn't work out that way, I could tape it and watch it at my own leisure.
Well, I took the distance learning course because it's I'm able to watch the videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that. I can watch it at home or either at the media center, and I would recommend this to a friend.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment. Doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So, for instance, Teatro will do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in middle school or here on campus. A number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring like Cultural Clash in or a Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks. And we tour it to local 7th grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Hi, my name is Monique McNeil. I'm currently attending California State University Dominguez Hills from West Los Angeles College. I chose Dominguez Hills because I heard about the great facility and the great people.
What a wonderful way to celebrate our 50th anniversary. The program, the faculty, the staff, and students have ensured that this library represents the multiple cultures that represent not only CSU Dominguez Hills, but the entire South Bay of California. And for that, I think we need to thank Dean Parham, faculty, staff, students, and of course our members of our Board of Trustees.
On behalf of the Board of Trustees, obviously we are excited about this achievement. We're excited about it, not just because it's a library for students, but what it means for the community.
The construction of this library is an important milestone in the growth and development of this university, and it helps to define what the California State University is all about.
Good afternoon. I cannot tell you how much this day means to me and to our university, but let me first acknowledge and thank our wonderful president for supporting me during this project.
Thank you so much for being here and celebrating with us during our 50th anniversary and the opening of our library. Thank you.
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles. The South Bay Resource Network and the South Bay One Stops are here to help you grow.
I found out about the One Stopper representative in my store and presented the services that they provide.
We have had, since we've opened, over 4,000 applicants. We only had 125 jobs, and One Stop really helped us find the true gems out of all those people.
On the business side, the One Stop provides not only training, but it provides a resource for contacts, also provides a resource for training, which is available to take someone there to actually train and use the facility. They offer computer classes, a myriad of things that they do.
It was just a great experience. The members of the One Stop were always helpful and understanding.
With services designed to help your business succeed, the South Bay Resource Network is here for you. Call 310-970-7799 or visit our website at southbayresource.net.
The One Stop is your resource for business in the South Bay.
This is my mercy.
Hey, Mark. Nice paper.
Now this is sweet.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University in Ingalls Hill.
Hey, welcome back to TV 407 Language Learned. I'm your host, Dr. Dan Grissel, coming to you live online from the beautiful campus of California State University at Dominguez Hills. Hour number two, folks. We're talking all about culture today. I'm going to participate in some culture the rest of the day. My 6-year-old and 5-year-old are both participating in AYSO soccer now. I was really blessed, though. My son, his coach is Lee Hancock, who's actually on the faculty here at Dominguez Hills. Lee's a great PE instructor in the phys ed department. He's actually a soccer coach. I was like, man, he's a shot with our coach. That's great. This is an interactive class, and we've been getting a lot of emails, and we got one phone call from Terrell so far. I love getting the phone calls. Give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu. And I'm sorry if I don't get to your email, but don't worry, folks. Anybody's emailing, I am getting a whole printout after class of everybody that had questions and comments during the class. I always love to look at what people are talking about. And the question of the week this week, we are asking, what is your definition of culture, and how does culture affect your classroom? And our fun question is, what are your favorite cultural activities here in Los Angeles? We begin some really good ideas, and a couple of them are actually occurring this weekend. This doesn't try to always, because reading is my thing, folks. I'll tell you right now, you want to get any of your ESL students to be better in English, get them reading for fun. Get them reading whatever they want for fun, whatever they want to. That's the key, folks. If they love reading about NASCAR, get them some NASCAR books. If they want to read about J-Lo, get them a biography on J-Lo. You know, I think textbooks are the root of all evil. They give money to political campaigns so that their textbooks will be mandated in different schools. And a textbook is a great way to get a kid to not want to read. I mean, my old principal, Mrs. Lucifer, used to ask me if I was using my textbook, and I would honestly say yes, because they make great doorstops, but they're not a good way to get kids to love reading. I can't tell you how many seventh grade boys I've taught that there is no way they're going to read this textbook, but if I give them a manual on how to fix a Chevy, they'll memorize it from cover to cover. The research is real clear on this, folks. It doesn't matter what you read, it matters how much you read. You know, research is clear on this, folks. Doesn't matter if you're reading James Joyce or James and the Giant Peach. People who read more read better. I'm on an airplane at least once a week, and I cannot remember the last time I was sitting next to somebody who was enjoying Dostoevsky or Molière or Maya Angelou. but I sit next to plenty of people who are reading USA Today, People Magazine, and Dan Brown. That's fine. Good readers read all the time. That's culture, too. It's a cultural thing. Getting kids to love reading. I want to create that culture. That's part of the classroom culture I want to create. Even for this class, if you look at my syllabus, the only test is the e-test, but I have a whole big list of recommended readings, and those are all books that are meant to inspire you. Some of the things that are thrown at teachers are theoretical and nonsense. I want some reading stuff that's going to make you want to jump into that classroom right away. I'm hoping these videos have been doing that for you. So I'm just going to read aloud. This one isn't from a book. I was going online. I found this site called anecdotage.com, and they have all kinds of little funny little anecdotes. I'm always looking for little tales to talk about, and I was looking for some funny ESL anecdotes, and so these are truth and advertising, a couple of anecdotes. Frank Perdue of Perdue Chicken, he proudly declared that it takes a tough man to make a tender chicken. Well, when they ran the ad campaign in Spanish-speaking countries, the Spanish translation read, it takes a sexually stimulated man to make a chicken affectionate. So there was a problem there in the translation. We lost the translation. People don't understand when you translate, you can't always translate directly because something gets lost in the translation. Here's some other funny ones that I've seen in different places. People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals was dismayed to learn that its dump dairy slogan translated as H.A. La Leche, which in Spanish is slang for discharged sperm. Good one. Colgate toothpaste learned that Colgate loosely translated means go hang yourself. So that was a tough one. General Motors discovered too late that Nova, you remember the Nova, Chevy Nova? Nova in Spanish means doesn't go. And so nobody was buying the cars. Why would you buy a car that doesn't go? I always love that. That's my favorite one of all time. Coors encouraged its English-speaking customers to turn it loose. Well, if you translate turn it loose into Spanish, literally, it means suffer from diarrhea. And finally, because the Spanish word for beer, cerveza, has a feminine ending, Budweiser became known to Spanish-speaking drinkers as the queen of beers, not the king of beers. The translation I get, what should you get out of that? Culture can greatly affect your meaning. I hope you got a kick out of those. I always do. If you ever have a funny anecdote or a funny little story to share, please send it in to me. I always love getting those. You can email it to me directly, or you can put it on Blackboard for everybody to see. Before I continue with all my little nonsense, I got a telephone call. I always love getting the telephone calls. Let's see who you have on the line. We got Cheryl Ball from Los Angeles. How are you doing, Cheryl?
Fine, thank you. Thank you for your program.
Thank you so much. Oh, what can I do for you today, Cheryl?
My comment was this. I loved your anecdote about your fifth grade student that you were teaching to read using the MBA staff.
Yeah.
And you hear a million stories about wonderful creative teachers who use the driver's manual or who use teen magazines or whatever the high interest was for the student, right?
Yes.
But the fact is that in the public school system, at least in Los Angeles, and I would venture to say in California, that would be absolutely forbidden to do.
Mm-hmm.
People would be reviewing you, evaluating you, observing you, and you would be heavily censured for doing that.
Mm-hmm.
The programs that we use now are rigidly enforced. You may not go off script. You've heard all these stories, but all of us have stories about our wonderful fourth grade teacher who did these incredible things, and those people aren't allowed to do that kind of teaching anymore. And that's the tragedy of public schools now.
It's absolutely, Cheryl, you and I are in complete agreement. It's completely tragic, and it's not just Los Angeles, it's not just California, it is everywhere. They were griping about it yesterday to me in Georgia, and that's one of the points I always make to people is, you know, I love surrounding myself with positive energy. I love reading about all these great teachers, and I love watching inspirational movies about great teachers. And I always say, you know, I've never seen that inspirational teaching movie that said, he went to the university to teach minority students, and he got them excited about school by using the standardized scripted reading program. I've never heard that. Yeah. I completely agree with you, Cheryl, that it's a bunch of nonsense.
Just one thing is that I had a next-door neighbor teacher for many years. Am I off? I had a next-door neighbor teacher for many years who did everything through cooking. She was a kindergarten teacher. About math, science, reading, everything. through cooking every day. Well, she hasn't done that since the year 2000 when the scripted program came in, and what a loss. What a loss that was. It was how creative that, and I always think of the memories that those children will have of that teacher and that program.
Absolutely, Cheryl. I actually just this morning I wrote a letter to USA Today because they were siding with the Los Angeles Times for recently publishing the test scores effectiveness of all the 6,000 teachers in Los Angeles Unified, and I've taken huge issue with them publishing those test scores. I mean, the reason I take issue with that is I don't believe the test score is a valid measure of a teacher's effectiveness. I can remember all kinds of great teachers that did cooking things with me and told stories that I loved and played games with us and inspired me, but I can't say the most effective teacher I had was the one that boosted me to the next quartile in the government accepted reading exam. So I completely agree with you, Cheryl. It's fucking crazy what's going on out there. And, you know, I was really blessed. I had a wonderful mentor when I was teaching in college. I taught at a school where I was the only white person in my school. I was the only man in my school. And I taught with predominantly elderly African-American women from the South. We'd all been teaching for at least 30 years. And my mentor was a woman by the name of Mrs. Turner. And Mrs. Turner, she took me under her wing because I was having this principal that was writing me up every day for doing those kind of innovative things you're talking about. And she was killing my energy. And my mentor, Mrs. Turner, she said, don't let that negative energy affect you. She's like, you got to do as I do. So do as I do, Cheryl. Next time you got that person that comes in your classroom, you do this. Go, So do that at home. Go, And then you go, Then you shut your way. Mrs. Turner told me, she's like, Mrs. Sell, I've been teaching this in this school for 40 years. They've had 35 different reading programs. I got one. Mine, and it works. She's the greatest mentor I could have possibly had.
Except this year, her name will be in the Times.
Absolutely. And I'll put her as an ineffective teacher. Absolutely right, Cheryl. You can have that anytime. I love that phone call. You and I are completely.
But you know, I shouldn't say that to everybody. Don't tell me if you just agree with me. Tell me if you disagree with me as well. So thank you so much for your call, Cheryl. I really appreciate that. And get that, spread that message out. More people have to hear that, that we need to be encouraging teachers, not telling them how to do their jobs, because everybody feels like they're an expert on education because everybody went to school. And it's a very scary thought what's happening out there. I've seen all these great innovative things gone down the toilet. It's exactly what Cheryl's talking about, because it's so rigid. Everybody has to be on this page at this time so that they can boost the test score 1%, and it's mostly nonsense. So thank you, Cheryl, so much. I really appreciate that call, and it is affecting some of our best teachers out there. And I want us to think about now, specifically about culture. When we're talking about the cultures that are meeting, I want you to imagine a time that you've been in a place where you didn't know anybody, and you couldn't follow their conversation easily when you're around people. How'd you feel? In your situation where you felt a little bit uncomfortable, where you felt out of place, and I want you to think about that, and I want you to think about what could others have done, or what could you have done to make you feel more comfortable. And while you're thinking about that, now I want you to consider the ESL kid in your classroom. This kid is from, they're in a new land, the United States. They're in a new setting, the public school system here in the United States. They have new acquaintances, you, their teacher, and their new classmates. They're speaking a tongue foreign from what is your tongue, your language. I just want you to think about how difficult this can be, how trying it can be for this student. And it's really something I want us to get out of this class. I want us to build up some empathy. I want us to build empathy for these students, because it really is not easy trying to learn English. English is a mess. English to me is a lot like America. It's stronger for its diversity, but it's a mess when it comes to rules, because they contradict each other all the time. And it's really kind of a shame that we're trying to standardize things. I've always thought that our strength is having all these differences and stuff, and those are differences. You know, Cheryl and I obviously agree on everything, but I don't want just people agreeing with me to call. I want people disagreeing with me to call. I love having those conversations with people. And I mean, and thank goodness people disagree with me. What a boring culture if everybody had the same culture. It would also really make capitalism not exist, because there'd be no competition, because everybody would want vanilla ice cream. You know, I like different flavors. I like Baskin Robbins. It's their 31 flavors. And that's why I love teaching at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Everybody looks different here. They're different ages. They're different religious groups. They're different ethnicities. You know, I love that. I embrace that. It makes for a great discussion. Okay. I know I'm going to talk too much today, and I have to get to this movie. The movie that changed my life is Stephen Miller, about Inez Amante. I once wrote an essay that was controversial, and I want to explain why it's controversial. I wrote an essay, and it was called Why I Hate Dead Poets Society. I already can feel people saying,
"She hates Dead Poets Society."
I hate Dead Poets Society. I'm going to tell you right now, here's the reason. It's basically, here's the gist of the essay. I'm going to compare Dead Poets Society with Stand and Deliver. Okay? Dead Poets Society stars Robin Williams, who plays a teacher, a fictional teacher, who goes to an elite prep school in New England to teach English. And he inspires his students by being orthodox, by teaching poetry and getting them passionate about poetry. Okay. Stand and Deliver is the true story of Jaime Escalante going to Garfield High School in East Los Angeles, almost a 99% Hispanic, a lot of ESL student population there, low income. And he teaches AP Calculus and inspires his students to love mathematics. Okay, now, in Dead Poets Society, one of the students, because of his new teacher, has begun to feel empty inside of his life, and he winds up committing suicide. Now, the school doesn't like the unorthodox approach that Robin Williams' character's been using. They take it as an opportunity to get this teacher fired, and so they have all of his students sign a petition saying that he should be fired, he does actually, it results in him actually being terminated. Okay, now, in Stand and Deliver, all of Escalante's students take the AP Calculus exam, and they all pass it, but the testing bureau, because they see where the students are from, do not believe that the students could pass such a difficult exam, and so they accuse the students of cheating. Well, Escalante gets them to take the test again. Okay. Here's the critical difference between these two movies. Okay. Dead Poets Society, the very last scene, the ultimate scene with very inspirational music, it shows Robin Williams' character. He's leaving the classroom for the last time, and one of his students, Ethan Hawke, he feels really bad about signing the petition. So he stands up on his desk and he says, "Oh, so what happened?" Which is a poem that inspires him, that Robin Williams taught. And all of a sudden, all the students get up on their desk and go, "Oh, Captain, I'm Captain." And Robin Williams, he looks back at all of them and he's like, "Wow, they like me." And he leaves. Stand and Deliver. Escalante gets the kids to take the test over again. And guess what happens? They all pass the test again. Folks, here's why I hate Dead Poets Society and why I love Stand and Deliver. Dead Poets Society, here's the message. I don't give a hoot if the kids like me. I want my students to like me. That's great. That's not my job. My job is to be their teacher. It's something I always tell parents. I'm like, your kid doesn't need a friend. They need a parent. Kids don't need another friend. They need a parent. They need a teacher. My job is to teach them. If that character had actually taught those students, they wouldn't have signed any petition. Okay? Escalante, he's the teacher. I'll tell you why. His kids are accused of cheating, and the message he sends them is, you know what, kids? Life ain't fair. Sometimes you gotta take the test again, and this time I want you to ace it again. And they do. You can't give Escalante any day of the week. I love that. That's the message. That's absolutely the message. Life isn't fair. Things happen all the time. You just spend the rest of your life griping about, oh, you know what? If this happened, you know, if this person was elected, you know, if I'd gotten this opportunity, I hate those people. Do something different. All right, I want to be one of the persons that, you know what? It ain't fair. I want to beat the system next time. Maybe two. That's a teacher I want, man. Unfair things happen all the time. I look at all these poor ESL kids where I'm like, man, nobody's going to listen to Jesus. And I tell them, I'm like, here's what you got to do. You got a lot more adversity to to overcome. And guess what? That's what's going to make you stronger. Because you're used to it. That's how you're going to rock.
Yes.
I love that. I absolutely love that. I was watching the show Hard Knocks on HBO. It's about the New York Jets training camp. And special teams coach was getting ready to, he was basically telling a lot of these rookie players, a lot of you are going to be cut. But he related to them an anecdote he had heard in Australia with sheepdogs, and that a lot of these sheepdog owners, what they'll do for their ranches, they'll find a bunch of puppies, they look for the smallest runt, and they put like an X mark on the runt, and they come back a couple of months later, and they see if that if the runt has grown up, because they realize if he was able to grow up amid all the big dogs, this one has heart. He knows how to overcome adversity. You know, wow, that's a very interesting story. And it's the truth. You know, embrace it. Embrace the adversity. It's going to make you stronger. And I've always told my kids, anything worth having is worth working. It's something you have to work for. You got to work for it. If it's given to you, you never care about it. You know, when I give speeches, I'm always paying. If you give something free, people don't respect it. You got to have them pay for it. That's the truth. You know, I always want my kids to expect nothing but the best, and I expect nothing but the best from them. So, I'm sorry, I totally got off. So, I guess I was introducing this clip from Stan and Liver. So, this is the very first clip I'm going to show you. Hopefully, three clips today. We'll see if we get to all of them. But this first clip is Jaime Escalante, Edward James Olmos, his first day on the job at Garfield High School. And a lot of people are like, oh, wow, that high school is really nasty. And like, folks, this isn't even one of the toughest high schools in Los Angeles, man. There are some schools that it can get really rough there. And I wish a lot of the people preaching the teachers on how to teach would try and teach in some of these settings for a week. Because I think it's a real special person with real special gifts. And I'm not making excuses for people, but I don't believe in excuses. But I do believe you need to give people context. So I hope you enjoy this first clip of Jaime Escalante's first day on the job in the wonderful film Stand and Deliver.
Now, exactly where was the fecal material found?
Back there in the corner. You'll know when you're near it.
This was mailed to me.
Just a minute. Excuse me, sir. If you don't have a telephone, would you bring in a gas field? We just need proof that you live in the district.
Excuse me. My name is Jaime Escalante, and I was supposed to teach computer science.
We don't have computers.
Mr. Escalante. We were supposed to get computers last year and the year before, and there's no funding from the game this year. Sat down with your fellow take on the gentleman and talk to the living.
I was supposed to teach him a few things.
I'm a teacher.
He's fine to see. Will everyone please try to find a seat? For those of you that cannot find a seat, please stand against the wall.
Hey, let's put our desk in a circle and discuss our feelings, sir.
We just speak for a seat.
Body to a desk.
Can we talk about sex?
Yeah. We discuss sex and get sexual homework. Stand back, everybody, please. Move back. Todos que no entienden inglés, por favor, levanten la mano. Please move forward if you do not speak English. Todos los que no hablan inglés, por favor, pasen para enfrente. This row, the first row, please stand up. Please move out.
How's the first one here?
I'll find you another seat. Okay. Hey, this is math 1A.
I don't need no math. I just go out there with my dozen donuts.
That's the exact change. No big deal.
Quiet. Quiet.
Thank you.
How do you expect to succeed in that kind of environment? And what's great about this movie is it shows you how a great teacher is able to transform that environment of low expectations into one of a culture of high expectations, and that's what all students deserve. Every week on this show, just to make sure everybody's watching the show, if you're enrolled in the class, your midterm and your final exams are going to be based on passwords that we're going to be giving you every single week. So this week, the password, the magic word, we're going to put it on the screen right now for everybody to see. The magic word that you want to write down, it's 9/11, so it is remember. Remember is our magic word for this week. So make sure you write that down, because your midterm, you're going to have to write down all of the different magic words for every single week. We'll just keep that on the air, and there we go. Okay, so let's get into a fun activity. All right, they say that America and England are two cultures divided by a common language. And so I wanted to see how good our English is in here. We'll see how good our English is. So I'm going to give you a translation activity. We'll see if we can translate the British into American. All right, so here's our first sentence. My column needs work on the buff of the windscreen and the bonnet and the wings. My column needs work on the buff of the windscreen, the bonnet, and the wings. All right, so what do you think a buffer is? A windscreen, a bonnet, and the wings. Buffer would be the bumper. Windscreen would be the windshield. Bonnet would be the hood. And the wings are the doors. All right, so there you go. One for one right now, okay? A few more. Okay, second sentence. And all of them, you start with the chemist and the news agent. So what's the chemist and what's the news agent? All right. Take a second. The chemist is referring to the pharmacy, the CVS, or Walgreens, or Rite Aid, or whoever we got. And the news agent would be a newspaper stand. Third sentence. Take the lift. It's just past the pillar box. All right. Do you know what the lift is or the pillar box? The lift, when they're talking about that in England, they're referring to the elevator. The pillar box, I was just in London recently with my family. The pillar box is the mailbox. So if you go to England, all the mailboxes are shaped like pillars, okay? Fourth one. I called the booking office and they were all out of stalls. I called the booking office and they were out of stalls. Booking office would be like Ticketmaster, ticket office. And stalls would be seats. Finally, last one. Run that student franking machine and post them. What's the franking machine and what's posting mean? Franking machine would be like a postage meter, and post them would be to mail them. All right, so let's see. Maybe we're getting a little bit better British every now and then. We'll try it. We'll try it out. So that is our translation activity. Okay, let's talk about cultural context. I actually did talk a little bit about this 2 weeks ago. We were talking about assimilation and acculturation, so I'm not going to go too much into that. In your e-text, those of you that, actually almost all of you purchased the e-text, and if you ever miss class, the e-text follows. If you look at your readings every single week, every single class's topics are based on the readings from that chapter. So this is week two. You're supposed to be reading chapter two. It's all in there, folks. So cultural great educational jargon about culture in your e-text. But I want you to try and figure out things and put them into English. To me, I like looking at the four stages of acculturation of our ESL students. I think it's important for us to be aware of these as teachers. There's basically four stages of acculturation. First of all, there's euphoria. Euphoria in English is the moment when you first get to a country, you're so excited and you're anxious. What's going to happen next? Culture Shop is our next stage. And Culture Shop is the novelty of the new culture gives way to reality. You're starting to feel angry and sad and you're freaking out. And then Culture Shop is followed by anime. Anime is where you don't know where you fit anymore. You're stuck in between two cultures. And then finally, we have assimilation or acculturation. We talked about that 2 weeks ago. Assimilation is when you decide just to completely accept that host culture is your own. Acculturation is when you decided I'm going to accept the host culture, but I'm not going to do it at the expense of my own culture. I'm going to have both of those cultures together. And I, you know, I was really blessed because I was in Spain for a while. And when I lived in Spain, I went through these stages because first, I was so excited about being there. And I really started to realize the culture shock is very difficult functioning in Spanish all the time. When you're functioning in another language all the time, you get headaches and you have nightmares. It's really interesting and it's very difficult. And anime, you start to wish you were back home, but you don't know what to do. And then I finally reached the point where I really embraced it. I really embraced living in Spain and I kept my American identity, but I also, there are so many things about Spain that I loved. So that was my personal example. So let's go into culture and academic success and try and get through some stuff to make sure we get to it. There's three theoretical models that attempt to explain culture's effects on academic success we're going to talk about. First of all, there's the genetic inferiority model. It assumes that certain groups are incapable of intellectual achievement. Basically, it's rooted in racism. Oh, they would never learn that. So that's one model of culture and academic success. Then there's the cultural deficit model. This model suggests that ethnic minorities fail in school because their cultures are inadequate in some way. It's kind of blaming the victim is the basis of this model. It's a little bit different than the genetic inferiority model because this one thinks that your culture, we can correct the problem through remediation. You know, we can help you. The one I'm a little bit more comfortable with than those two models is what's called the cultural mismatch model. And this proposes that members of many minority groups may not succeed in school because the characteristics of their cultures differ from those in macro-culture classrooms. So the cultures are at odds, and so the school culture doesn't meet the needs of this student's culture. And so it was interesting when we go back to that movie Spellbound, that teacher was talking about, oh, I know the Indian students are very driven to achieve. And so, well, they're going to do well in school if that's the basis. I would have been interested to hear her, and I don't, you know, she's a nice woman, but, you know, you also hear these people say, oh, that kid can't achieve because they're this or they're that. You know, I believe that you got to set those expectations high, folks. I think you're setting yourself up for failure when you believe in negativity like that. You know, the thing I like about the cultural mismatch model is over the last 30 years, there's been a lot of support for this model. Through this model, we've gotten Howard Gardner's multiple intelligence theories that everybody has their strengths in different areas. The recent differentiated instruction discussion that meeting the needs of different learning styles in our classroom set through product process contextual interaction has also attracted a lot of attention in recent years. Researchers recognize that there are differences between ethnic minority cultures and ethnic cultural values, mainstream, that may be prevalent in our American schools. And so it's important for us to pay attention to these different points of views. Let me get back to your emails because I'm getting a lot of emails today. I just got one from Giovanni. Thank you. Giovanni, I love the name Giovanni. Giovanni writes, I've been teaching an advanced ESL course at an adult school for the last year in Santa Monica. Great, that's a great experience, Giovanni. And my student demographic is very heterogeneous. I have students from South America, Europe, all of Asia, etc. Great. The students still seem to gravitate towards peers from their country that's natural, and thus end up speaking their native languages. Yeah, we want to try and prevent that, but it's natural. Why is it okay for students, youth, and adults to speak their native language in a multicultural English class? Well, again, that's you, Giovanni. That's all up to you. That's the culture you want to create. Do you want to create a classroom culture where they're permitted to speak that language, or do you really want to focus specifically on English? My tendency would be to really focus, if your purpose is English, would be to try and focus on the English, but allow them to communicate in native language to help them out a little bit. So thank you so much for that email, Giovanni. We're running low on time. I want to get to this other clip of Stand and Deliver. And so, okay, I want to show you another clip from Stand and Deliver. And this is Escalante meeting resistance from a student. A lot of us, we always have one student that doesn't want to play ball with us. And I'm always interested to see how different teachers handle different situations. You know, some teachers scream, some teachers, they succumb, some teachers just ignore it. Let's see what Escalante does when he encounters a student who's not there to learn, that resistance students. This is about a 3-minute clip from Stand and Deliver, starring Edward James Olmos.
Thank you, Garcia. When I see Garcia, you answer, okay? Are your friends out of the team?
I asked them to come with me.
I will say Cyclone from Bolivia. One man gang. This is my domain. Don't you know glass? A jump on your face. Tattoo your chromosomes. This is basic math, but basic math is too easy for you, burros. So I'm gonna teach you algebra because I'm the champ. And if the only thing you know how to do is add and subtract, you'll always be prepared to do anything. Pump gas?
Yeah, ripping up a gas station better than working in one, you know?
I'm a tough guy. Tough guys don't do math. Tough guys deep fried chicken for a living. Sorry, you want a wing or a leg, man? Whoever heard of negative and positive numbers? Anybody?
Yeah, negative numbers are like unemployment. 10 million people out of work, that's a negative number.
We're gonna need a lot of Kleenexes. It's gonna be a lot of bloodshed. You ever been to the beach?
Yeah.
You ever play with the sand? Finger man. Come on. You want to dig a hole? The sand that comes out of the hole, that's a positive. The hole is a negative. That's it. Simple. Anybody can do it. Minus 2 plus 2 equals. Hey. What do I mean? Answer it. Come on. You know the answer. Minus 2 plus 2, here's the hole. If I hit that on my hands, I wouldn't raise it either. Really? Come on, and negative 2 plus 2 equals. Anybody can do it. Feel the hole. Minus 2 plus 2 equals. Just feel the hole. You can do it. You don't have to do what you have at you. Simple. That's it. Minus 2 plus 2 equals 0. You just fill the hole. Did you know that neither the Greeks nor the Romans were capable of using the concept of 0? It was your ancestors, the Mayas, who first contemplated the 0, the absence of value. To start here, you will have math in your blood.
Equipo sabe todo, hermanos, everything. Órale. Equipo sabe.
You know, he's just an amazing teacher. I like him relating culture. You know, oh, your culture, your math is in your blood. Now, watch, folks. I mean, obviously, he does some things that are a little bit tricky. You know, I tend to stay positive with my students. I would never call out a kid the way Escalante does in there. But again, realize what Escalante is dealing with. He understands the motivation of his different students, and he understood those guys could take that. That's why he was going at them that way. I wouldn't do that, but again, you know what? you got to do what you're comfortable with. And he's a fantastic motivator out there. I mean, there's a lot of conversation out there like that, but that's what he had to do to get through to a couple of those reluctant students. I just think he's a fantastic teacher. Okay, so let's think about some baselines. Let's see if we can get a call in here. I'd like to look at some different cultural scenarios. Situation number one, let's see this. Marissa claims that because you are of a race different from hers, that you do not understand her, and therefore you cannot teach her anything.
What do you do?
What do you do when a kid does that?
What do you do?
I had that happen more than once. You don't know me. My God, you don't know me. What do you do in that situation? I want to think of some realistic options. And I want to look at different schools. What do we do? What do we do? Think about that and email it or phone it in if you have an idea. Here's another situation. During your history lesson, Sven becomes adamant in insisting that Norsemen first discovered North America. What do you do? What do you do? Okay, these are all cultural questions. Okay, here's another situation. You plan for an African American History Month celebration by encouraging student projects depicting African food, fashions, and festivals. Hakeem says, why do we only do this once a year? How do you respond to Hakeem? Situation four, Juan consistently brings to class scholarly literature that often disputes the facts of your lessons. What do you do? What do you do? See, I'm like that. I love playing devil's advocate here. What do you do? These are all situations I've observed in different classrooms before they've happened to me. And I'm always interested to see how different people would play them, would deal with the situation. Just another situation. Manny has disclosed his feelings of anger regarding a personal experience involving differential treatment on the basis of race. You point out to students that we all have the same feelings, and go on with your own agenda. Is that what you do? Is that what you do? I want to hear what your viewpoint is. And finally, last one, Latanya is always chatting and tells you when you attempt to reprimand her that girls are supposed to talk. Okay, how do you handle that situation? These are all cultural questions. What's the classroom culture that you have created? I want you to think about those, and we're running low on time right now, so I suspect a lot of us can't get to them, but feel free to still email them in or to call me right now if you have a chance, or ponder it. These questions I want you to be thinking about all the time. These are types of things I would love to hear calls about. What do we do in these different situations? Okay, just got a couple of emails. April just wrote in, I just got hired as an English tutor. Thank you, April, for emailing, by the way. I'm about mild and fluency speaking Spanish, mild and fluency like that. Do you have any advice on how to deal with parents of children who do not know much English? Well, one thing, April, just a quick one, is if those parents have access to the internet, if you go to any of the search devices like Google, you know what, I can show this to you right now on the screen. Google.com. If you go to Google, I just found out there's this website called Google. It's a really cool way. Okay, here we go. We got it on the screen right now. Google.com. Okay, now, most people, when they look at Google, they just type in things here in this box. They ignore the words around it, like the one over here to the right that says language tools. So I go to language tools. I have an area called translate text. So I type in, my name is Danny. I am handsome. Intelligent and modest. Okay? And it gives me a whole bunch of different languages. Look at all these languages. I'm going to go, I just typed it up in English. So I'm going to go English. And let's see which language we want to type it into. How about we just go English to Spanish? So I go English to Spanish. I click translate. Let's see what just happened. Look at that. It just took what I wrote, and here to the right says, mi nombre es Danny's. Yes, guapo, inteligente y modesto. Instant-free translation. Instant-free translation. That is an awesome tool. That is an awesome tool for my parents. Let me see if I have another part here. Okay, here, let's go back to that page there on Google. Okay, I'll show you how I use it with parents all the time. Translate a web page. Okay, I type in my web page, lazyreaders.com. Let's go again from English to Spanish. I click translate. It took almost a full 2 seconds there. Look at that. It just took my website, Lazy Readers, and just translated the entire web page into Spanish. and now that parent that doesn't speak English can actually help their kid with the homework. That's a pretty cool little thing. What did you say?
It was watching the show today.
Oh, man, I wanted to show this other clip from Steve Blip. I don't think I have enough time to do that. I want to just get back. We'll just wrap up with some suggestions on building up our cultural competency. But don't worry, folks, if I didn't get to your email, I'm going to read them all after class. I get a big list of all the comments everybody wrote. So here's some suggestions for cultural competency. And if I don't make sure out the whole list, don't worry. These are all in your ebook. First of all, become a student of the world. You know, if I became president of the United States, one of the things I would do is when everybody turns 18, I'd give them $10,000 to go live in another country. Preferably a country where people spoke a different language, they practiced a different religion, they were a different color. Because two things happen when you travel around the world, folks. First of all, you get a better perception of the rest of the world. So often we're very isolated here in just thinking American all the time. And secondly, you start to you develop a much better appreciation for a lot of the things we take for granted in this country all the time. Folks, there's a reason we have so many immigrants coming to the United States. It's a wonderful country. It really is the land of opportunity. At least I hope that we strive to be the land of opportunity. So become a student of the world. Try to spend a few minutes each day, just spend a few minutes, even Googling, trying to learn a little bit about the different cultures of your students. I mean, YouTube's also great now because I can watch little short videos of people on there. Become more aware of your own beliefs and how they're culturally determined. It's very important to understand yourself because, you know what, this is the point that I like to make. Because folks, I see things all the time, and I mean them one way, and people interpret them the other, another way. And, you know, it freaks me out when a person interprets me in a certain way, and if I in any way have a negative impact on a person, I want to understand that, and I want to apologize for that. You know, because most of the time I'm just trying to be funny, and if I hurt somebody's feelings, I want to know about that. So it's really important to understand ourselves as well as other people's cultures. Don't make any assumptions, and don't be afraid to ask. This is very important when we're learning about different cultures. Try to learn about contributions of people from other countries and cultures. Read history books, but look at history books that talk about the same event from different perspectives. Very important. Take a course on diversity. Take this course. We'll talk a little bit about it, but not a lot enough. There's other courses here that we offer in the education program. I think maybe Sheriff Fahima's class might actually do that. It's an online class. We want to learn to look for different biases in different materials and methods. I see it often in the testing and things like that. And yada, yada, yada. I'm not going to get through all of these, but the open mind is a very important one. Well, we're wrapping up, folks. I know I didn't get through anything. You got your ebooks. I'm really excited about this class. So thank you so much for your participation. I'll see you next week. Remember, folks, you make a difference every day. Enjoy your weekend. God bless. Thank you.